Welcome to Future Takes, a series where we ask people on their views on how we can reach a more reconciled island of Ireland. And today I'm delighted to be joined by the award-winning multi-instrumentalist, composer, singer, you can do everything, Rhiannon Giddens. Oh. Lovely to meet you. We're here in Dolan's in Limerick, which is a beautiful space, beautiful performance space. You've made Limerick your home. Mm-hmm. You're originally from North Carolina in the United States. But what made you want to make this part of Ireland and Ireland your home?
Well, me and my ex, we were married for many years. He's from Ireland and his family's from Limerick. And we had two kids and we were living in the States and we kind of made this decision. I kind of pushed, to be honest, a little bit because I knew that they are half American, half Irish, and if we didn't live in Ireland, they would never feel like they were at home in Ireland in a way, like, you know, to have the real Irish experience. And then I was also very committed to the language. So I knew that, you know, if we wanted them to have the cupola focal to speak the Irish, like, it was the only way was to be here, and we put them in a Gael school, and so it would be an everyday part of their lives.
And now that you have that, what is the value of the language within your family?
I see kind of both sides of it, because there's a lot of folks here who are frustrated with their Irish and, you know, and feel very conflicted about it, and then there's a lot of people who just love it and want to see it grow. For me, these conversations need to happen because, you know, a lot of a culture comes from language. And even the way that Irish people speak English is so heavily influenced by, you know, by the Irish language. And philosophy, you know, all of these things, you learn so much by learning the language.
Indigenous culture seems to be very important to you. So it doesn't surprise me that you wanted your children to speak Irish. When was it in your life that you made that connection with Indigenous culture? And what do you think it has brought to you as a person and as an artist?
That's a kind of a complicated question, because we treat things so reductively, like in the States, well, in so many places, like, you know, everybody's looking for the simple narrative. And growing up, you know, as a mixed race person in North Carolina, you know, my mom is Black, my dad's white. I know that there's, you know, Indigenous connections in the family. I kind of step out of, you know, any kind of trying to like research that or claim it or whatever. I just go, look, I'm a representative of a mixed Southern person, which is all three threads, Black, white, red, right? And I leave it there. In the States, indigeneity really is tied so much to that question of like blood quantum and Native Americans and what does that mean and how do we talk about it? Whereas really indigeneity is a worldwide phenomenon. It's really like the people who are there have been there for so long, they are, you know, they know the land, they know the area, they have this history that's connected there. And also the idea of that versus capitalism versus colonialism versus the something that values output rather than just inherent humanity. It's really important to connect and to investigate those, because we realize that we're actually all connected in this way. And it takes being willing to go, God, you know, these people that I'm sharing a name with or blood with, like, did some really terrible things. But there was a lot of people who got rolled over who live next door, like, who are also on this land that I'm also connected to. You know what I mean? Yeah.
So what are your thoughts on identity going forward? You know, particularly here in the island of Ireland, you know, can we get beyond this one-dimensional view of identity and maybe acknowledge that identity is made up of all those layers that you have just described?
For me, when I came to Ireland and we considered having our first child here, we ended up having her in the States for various reasons, but we had a one doctor visit when I was pregnant, and I went in and, you know, there's the form and it was like religion. And I was like, what? You know, and then I realized, well, here we're a mixed marriage because I'm not Catholic, whereas at home we're a mixed marriage because we're not the same race. Neither one of those things has any bearing on our humanity, right? The religion, the race, they're all external things. Race is a completely made up thing, but the effects are very powerful. And it's trying to realize that the divisions are made up, but the effects are very real. I think trying to hold space for both of those things so that, like, I can say my life as a person this color, you know, has been a certain way because of the country that I've lived in, mm-hmm. has decided that certain things. But it doesn't mean that I identify as a brown person. I have to go, my life is what it is because of the way that they set up these things, and that's affected by how I look. But my innermost soul has nothing to do with race.
So looking at communities being divided on elements of their identity, and particularly in the context of this series of discussion, what do you think can break down the barriers and find common ground?
I mean, I really think as an artist, I see everything through the lens of art, and I think art is huge for that. I have a friend in the States who does a lot of research on Gaelic speakers in the United States, and like particularly Native and Black Gaelic speakers, because we say Native and Black, but for those people, they were Gaelic speakers, and that's all that mattered. And maybe their skin was dark, but they were raised, you know, in a Gaelic world. Maybe they were enslaved, maybe they lived in Canada. And these interactions between people of like, oh, you speak my language and you sing my songs. So the rest of it is immaterial. So language and culture and art really like connect us in that way. You know, there was a Black American Irish dancer, like in
Sainer,
right?
Yeah.
Fantastic, right?
Yeah.
The amount of crap that she got in her comments, like Instagram, and she was like, oh, an amazing dancer. And I'm like, well, first of all, let's talk about the history of of Irish step dance. You know what I mean? I mean, it's like, it's complicated too. Why would you like tear her down when it's literally melanin and that's the only difference between her and like somebody else? Like, it's just wild to me. And then there were the two brothers. I think they're brothers or, you know, who like brought her into their Instagram. They're Irish dancers too.
Yes.
They're from Ireland, you know? And I'm like, that's powerful.
You know, you're a mixed race woman, made Ireland her home. Your kids now that are Irish. How do you see that aspect of the Irish identity evolving as we go forward? You know, given the unrest and the terrible scenes we've seen in the last number of months where it comes to anti-immigrant protests.
Think about my mother, well, my mother outlaw, I suppose. my ex's mom, Martha, she's from Westmeath. Now, she was a blow-in to Limerick, right? She was an outsider. Like, that was the way it used to be. You know, you were from 100 kilometers that way, but that's the same as any kind of small, you know, population society. Like, you're from the village down the way, you're never gonna be from here, you know? And when you think of how the world has shrunk and how it could be somebody from halfway around the world has made their home here, and now their kids are like, well, this is all I've known. You know what I mean? And maybe I have some spicy food at dinner, but like, their experience is Irish, you know? We have to reject the idea that how you look has anything to do with what your experience is. Mm. And it's a lot to do because everything in our world reinforces that. That's the fight here. Because there hasn't been hundreds of years of entrenched racism, like there's hundreds of years of entrenched other kinds of prejudice, right? Religious-based and all of that. You know, it's an opportunity to, how can we look at this in a way that is not going to take us down this road that so many other countries have gone down?
The saying of William S. Burroughs, artists are the real architects of change, not the political legislators who implement change after the fact. And I wonder, everything you've said about the projects you've been involved in, living here in Limerick, like, in your opinion, what is the role of the artist, the musician, the storyteller, the tradition carrier on this changing island?
So artists who ideally exist outside of the system, making, you know, art that is meaningful, art that is speaking to change, that is speaking to things that need to happen, you know, musicians and artists and creatives are often, you know, the canaries in the coal mine. You know, they feel that change, they feel that need first. They can also affect those people who are in those positions of power. You know, you could have a lawyer that hears a song by a well-known folk musician talking about something that happened, and it affects his desire to then go make legislative change, you know, which I know has happened, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's like, ultimately, you have all of these people working in concert. you know? Because it's like, I can't write a law, but I can inspire somebody to write one. I can't vote for everyone, but I can inspire somebody to vote. I can't, you know, say, hey, think about somebody else's point of view, but I can sing a song that makes somebody think about somebody else's point of view. You know what I'm saying? So that's what I think art is for.
You talk about speaking to power through your work, and you choose your projects really carefully. Songs like Julie, you know, your lyrics, your song choices also highlight the repression of women. Mm-hmm. And you've spoken openly about how important it is for you to use your platform to give women a voice. So I wonder, in the context of this Future Take series, it's looking to the future on the island of Ireland. How important is it to have women driving that future on the island, given the divisions of the past?
I think it's incredibly important. And women have been involved in every major force, you know, for change on this island. Like, you know, whether they get heralded for that or not is another topic, but like, they've always been involved, and they've always, just as, you know, the civil rights movement in the United States had a huge underpinning of women that didn't always get the, you know, the statues and stuff, but if they hadn't been there, it would have completely collapsed. So I think there's a very strong well of feminine strength, well, whatever the term, women, here. And I think that they have to be involved. You have to be involved. That's it. You know, because first of all, you just need everybody in a society to be engaged. You need women, and you need men. You need older people, you need younger people, you need poor people, you need rich people, you need everybody. So you have all the different, you know, all the different experiences at the table. But women in particular, because of what we're expected to do, you know, because we're expected to, you know, hold the kids and hold the home and now also hold the career. And we're expected to do all of these things. And I don't think that's right. You know, I think that there's a lot that needs to be done in terms of how each family group decides how, you know, how things are allocated.
Rhiannon, this has been an incredible conversation, where we started, where we've ended up. Just to finish up, this is your opportunity, your pitch now, right? So if you could talk to the powers that be and set out how we could live better together on this island in the years ahead, what would you say?
I really think education is always the key. Education and focusing on communication and conversation rather than division and rather than, you know, performative stuff. I mean, it has to happen island-wide, but it has to happen in the micro to happen in the macro. So like, this small community, there have to be, you know, ways of inviting them to talk to each other and to have moments where they can come together and communicate with each other. But that takes time, and it takes expertise. It takes bringing in people who can maybe work with, you know, I mean, it really, it takes a focus on what is life like for the average person in this area, and like, listening. You know, and then going, okay, how can we foster this idea of what it means to be on this island, no matter where you come from?
So many incredible messages in this conversation today, Rhiannon Giddens. It's been wonderful to talk to you. Thank you very much.